You're listening to Cloud 9, where BahaiTeachings.org interviews artists from around the globe to learn about what inspires, uplifts, and motivates them to make a positive contribution to the world. My name is Shadi toloui-wallace. Our Cloud 9 guest artist in this episode has earned multiple Grammy Awards and accolades as a producer, engineer, and songwriter in a career that has spanned over almost four decades. He's produced and written works for artists like Carlos Santana, Ricky Martin, Bon Jovi, Janet Jackson, Luis Miguel, Khaled, Ozymandias, Anna Gabriel, Selena, Michael Jackson, and the list just goes on and on. He's made critical contributions to the music world by introducing Western audiences to Latin music and also introducing Anglo music to the Spanish-speaking world by translating hit songs for artists like Boyz II Men, Sting, Brian McKnight, and Toni Braxton, and again, the list goes on and on. Our guest artist in this episode is also a performer and recording artist in his own right. He's made appearances on stages all over the world and released two solo projects under his own name, most recently an album titled Crucenderos, which he released last year. He is also one of the founding members of Oneness, a nonprofit organization that promotes racial unity through music, arts, and education. Our guest artist in this episode is none other than Casey Porter. Born in Los Angeles, Casey's parents, who were both successful artists and also members of the Baha'i faith, accepted an invitation in the 1970s to move to Guatemala as a family when Casey was just 7 years old. It was here that Casey's parents would assist in strengthening the local Baha'i community of Guatemala, and it was during this time that Casey was first exposed to Latin sounds, rhythms, and instruments. In his interview with Cloud 9, we'll hear recollections of what it was like to work with some of the world's biggest artists in bridging the West with the Latin music world. We'll learn more about his organization, Oneness, and his recent album release. We'll also discuss the role and impact that faith and spirituality has undoubtedly had on his own successful career. Casey Porter, welcome to Cloud 9.
Great to be with you. Thank you for having me.
So let's take things back a bit. You were born in Los Angeles, and in the early 1970s, when you were just 7 years old, your parents left their successful careers to move you and your family to Guatemala, a country that was in the midst of a military dictatorship and a civil war. Most people would have thought your parents were crazy, but as Baha'is, it's quite common to leave a comfortable life in pursuit of establishing Baha'u'llah's world-embracing vision of unity and oneness in other parts of the world. So could you walk us through this transition and the impact it had on your own faith as a child?
What I remember is my father told me that he was asked by a prominent musical figure, a guy named Russ Garcia in Los Angeles, who asked him if he might be able to conduct the Baha'i choir while he had to leave for a few weeks to go to New Zealand. So my father accepted this job, not really knowing much about anything other than, you know, that I think Russ Garcia had given him a copy of a book called A Thief in the Night, which is a beautiful book that really was inspiring my dad. So he Russ Garcia said, can you help me out with this? So he went to the Baha'i Center, and when he got there, he just said that he saw this diversity that he had never really seen before. And he just said to himself, this is what I've been looking for all my life. And it just really, to be exposed to people of all races, just in a way that he hadn't seen before. So he ended up becoming a Baha'i, and my mother kind of grappled with it a little bit. Over time, she became a Baha'i, and I think a year later, it took my mom quite a while to fully embrace the Baha'i faith. But then she and he decided they wanted to do something greater, which was to go to Guatemala. So we are now on an airplane. I'm seven. We had sold our home, had the garage sale, the whole thing, and we're going into a country where, yeah, I had no idea what was going on. And I don't know if my parents knew what was going on in Guatemala with politically, but we went there, and it changed my life without a doubt. I learned a whole new culture, and and just kind of stepped out of a comfort zone that was really, you know, I had a, you know, wonderful, you know, this life where living in a nice suburban neighborhood in Los Angeles. And, I think the hardship that I got to experience wasn't that bad, but it was so much more enlightening and more, it was just, you know, it really changed who I am. And, you know, that's the next story.
We'll come to that. So it's without a doubt that your immersion in Latin music is a result of your family's faith and their decision to move to Latin America. So I'd love to now talk about what this experience was like for you on a musical level. What sorts of sounds and rhythms were you exposed to? Who or what inspired you? And who were you able to collaborate with and learn from during your time and your teens in Guatemala?
The interesting thing is the music that people were listening to in Guatemala was, there was either music like cumbia music, which was what, anyway, there was cumbia music, and there was also like the more pop kind of romantic music, like either Camilo Sesto or Jose Jose or Julio Iglesias or Roberto Carlos from Brazil singing in Spanish. So all of a sudden, I am just listening to all this beautiful romantic music. And what was really the import music for Guatemala was the romantic music from abroad. So I was listening to like Latin romantic music and then global romantic music. And there was some rock and roll, but I didn't get as much rock and roll because it was just really, it's such a romantic culture that, so the rock and roll was just kind of like a hidden thing that it was harder to find that, even though I would go on to produce a lot of rock bands from Latin America, I kind of got a sensibility for romantic music.
Interesting. So we'll delve more into this influence later on in the interview. But coming back to like the beginnings of your music career, I know I'm simplifying things here a bit, but after roughly 10 years in Guatemala, you returned to the United States to study music and soon began working as an arranger, composer, and producer in Los Angeles. Now, having been immersed in Latin culture and music for so many years, I'm really curious about what your observations were surrounding Latin music in the West at the time and what you believed your experience would bring to the table. I think I'm just really curious about that breakthrough moment that you saw in bridging these two worlds.
Well, I don't think there was like this aha kind of moment in this sense. I mean, it was a time when global Latin artists were trying to figure out what their production would sound like and if their options were to record in their hometown or to record in Spain, which was like really, that was like the production hub for a lot of Latin artists, or to go to Los Angeles. That we became kind of like the go-to place for artists that wanted to get that international sound. So it was, I always feel like I kind of like, it was unfair from, you know, for other people that were trying to figure it out. And I'm sitting here in Los Angeles where all the studios are, where all the engineers are, the greatest diversity and, you know, the resources were here, the musicianship, you know, was just amazing. So, I always feel like it was unfair, but I also grew up with a father who is an arranger that really gave me empowered me, you know. So I really feel like arranging a song, knowing the chords, you know, knowing all the stuff that a lot of producers may not know. I really feel like I had that advantage. So that was really great. My father did a lot of arranging for TV shows when he was in LA. For TV shows like Lassie or Woody Woodpecker or Laugh-In or a lot of different, you know, just very diverse. And that was something he did give up when he went to Guatemala. So, yeah.
And like we have, you know, we're talking like Janet Jackson, Jerry Halliwell, mm-hmm. which I know from the Spice Girls, Bon Jovi, Brian McKnight, like these huge musicians like Sting. Like what was going on in the United States or in the Western music world that compelled these really well-known Western artists to start singing their same songs, but in Spanish?
Yeah, well, I had been working at A&M, so there was a lot of the A&M artists from Sting to Janet to Lady in Red. Christa Berg was A&M. They also had, I think, U2. I wish we could have done U2 in Spanish. But a lot of people were realizing that there was like 500 million people in Latin America, and trying to get that, all you had to do was do a Spanish version of your song. Well, and all of a sudden you'd have, you know, that those numbers as new fans. I think everybody was interested in that. I remember Bon Jovi was saying, like, "What do I really have to do this?" And and I say, "Well, you know, there's like 500 to 600 million people in Latin America." And he's just like, "Okay, let's do it. You know, no problem." But I think labels want, but it ended up changing the landscape of Latin music, in my opinion, because a lot of stuff that we did, like Toni Braxton or Boyz II Men, we did a whole album with Boyz II Men. The Evolution album was done in Spanish, so that I think made its way to the Latin audiences, and then before you know it, you start seeing these R&B influences in Latin music, and that was really exciting to see, and it's still lingers to this day.
Well, yeah, absolutely. Like, we hear so much cumbia, reggaeton, so much influence from South America entering or being introduced to the Western music scene. So it's wonderful to hear kind of where the beginnings were and how you were a part of it. So in addition to working with some of the biggest names in Western entertainment and translating their hits to Spanish for the Latin audience, you also worked with some of South America's most popular artists, Los Fabulosos, Selena, and Ricky Martin, just to name a few, as you'd already mentioned. How did these collaborations come about, and what were you hoping to really introduce for the first time to a Western audience?
Well, I had been doing a lot of pop music, a lot of Latin pop, and the Fabulosos Cadillacs came along. Their manager was a good friend of mine, and he said, "Hey, there's this band, and we're trying to find a producer for them." And I didn't feel like it was right in line with what I had been doing. And I played some for my wife, who's a big Specials and English Beat fan, and she just said, "Oh my gosh, you got to do these guys." So we immediately agreed to this, and the media was all over this one, saying like, "Oh, these guys are gonna, their sound will be ruined. This guy's a pop producer, and they're from Argentina, and the guy who was the big pop rock or the rock producer of Argentina, Gustavo Santaolalla, who later would go on to make, you know, the scores for Brokeback Mountain and North Country. I mean, he won back-to-back Oscars. It's amazing. And he came to me and said, you know, "You're not a rock producer, you know."
Right.
And I said, "Well, you know what? We're just having fun here. You know, we're doing our thing." And it ended up being like a big, you know, big, great thing. And the song Matador came from it. And now it's a big anthem. And at the soccer stadiums, when someone's about to score, everybody sings the song, "Matador, Matador," yeah. You know. So it's, I think the thing is, we get stuck in stereotypical things that we have to do. Ricky was a fluke thing. We gave him what he needed, what felt right, you know, giving him his roots back. And no one was putting roots into music. I think the fact that I didn't really, you know, carry one particular flag. I was more universal and global minded. So when I would come into a project like Ricky's, I was just thinking, what can we do from a Latin perspective, from an African perspective, from whatever perspective? It was really eclectic, and it was big and beautiful, and it had big strings, and it would have some rock and roll elements. And
yeah.
So Ricky really got a whole balanced, crazy, you know, mm-hmm. And the lyrics were unique too. We really cared about not just saying anything, and really, really thoughtfully piecing together albums. That was always something that was so important for me. You know, excellence in all things is something that the Baha'i writings talk about. So I really wanted to make sure that everything I did, if I put my seal on it, it had to be as excellent as I could make it.
Of course, of course. And tell me if you think this is too personal or racy, mm-hmm. but as to the question of identity, you're visibly this Caucasian American man, but inside you've got all these very strong Latin roots. So I'm really curious about how these artists perceived you and how you perceived yourself, and if you experienced any of this kind of like imposter syndrome that we hear a lot of people talking about when they're working with communities that are different to their own.
I think, you know, the critical years that I grew up were 7 to 17. So I really feel like I am kind of at my core, very Latino, you know, and I feel like it's a double-edged sword for me. And I feel like, and it's just like, if I want to turn on my Latin side, I'm Latin. If I want to turn on my gringo side, you know, I'm there for whatever occasion, you know, and it's great because I really feel like it opens doors in ways that, you know, nothing else could, you know. Language is so important, and but I understand the culture. So anyway, it's great. I felt no insecurity whatsoever. I felt like
it was like your superpower.
It was. Yeah. And I felt like I was empowered. I could speak English when I needed to, I could speak Spanish, but it is at the same time. And I think my approach to production was, what's the joke about how many producers does it take to screw in a light bulb? And it's like, I don't know, what do you think? That's the punchline, you know? And that really became kind of like this mantra for me, is when people would come to me and say, hey, what do we do? You know, they're fighting over what instrument they want to have. Is it acoustic guitar or is it electric solo, you know? And I just would ask them, what do you guys think? And then they would provide the answer ultimately. So it's kind of like I am more of a sounding board.
Right, like having a real humble posture of learning.
Although producers out there will say, are you guys kidding? No, you're going to use an electric guitar. And that's, you know, and I really feel like I think the approach of just letting them really find these answers for themselves, because ultimately they're going to have to live with this music day after day. And so they have to really find... Yeah. And ultimately, a lot of artists will go on to produce themselves, hopefully, you know, not even need me anymore.
Yeah. And it feels like you're really able to apply the teachings of the Baha'i faith when it comes to consultation and also accompaniment. And the other thing I was really reflecting on is this idea of like identity transcending race and gender and nationality. Would you say that the Baha'i faith was a big part of that as well?
Definitely. Yeah. Yeah. And I feel that every day. I mean, I'm conscious of that because at the core of what the Baha'i faith is all about is the unity of all humankind. So how can I not be trying to recognize that in everything I do? Because there is no exclusivity in what we do as Baha'is. It's so inclusive of all people, of all thought. Somewhere in the writings, it talks about to not come in saying like, I know everything and you don't know anything. That's not conducive to influence, right? As a teacher. But if you say like, I don't know, but let's investigate this together and find the truths together. That's a beautiful approach.
Yeah. And probably very unique and almost revolutionary for the music industry of that time.
Yeah.
So in 1999, you completed writing and producing Carlos Santana's album, Supernatural. You were awarded a Grammy for your work on the production of this record, which sold over 30 million copies worldwide. And you also won a Latin Grammy for your work on the single Corazón Espinado.
Yes, with Maná. Yes.
Could you share how that connection came about with Carlos and also the inspiration behind the album? Because I know that there is a very strong connection between the writings of Baha'u'llah, in particular, a book which he revealed called The Hidden Words, to this story and to this record.
Well, we had just finished releasing Ricky Martin's music, that there was a song, Maria. It became a big hit all around the world, and especially in France. It was a big, huge phenomenon. And Santana had been touring Europe, and he saw what a big phenomenon Ricky was. And he called our office when he got back to the U.S. and said, I want you to do what you did with Ricky, with me. And it's just kind of like there's no guarantee that can happen. It's just a lot of timing and a lot of good luck. But it was strange because we said, absolutely. I reached out to my good friend, JB Eckel, and JB was like, oh, dude, I'll do anything. And like, so we immediately, we set up an appointment. We went down to the studio And we met with Carlos, and the crazy thing was he starts pulling out all these paintings and posters, and we're looking at these paintings. Wow, these are beautiful, Carlos. Yeah. And then he just kind of looks at us and he said, "That's what I want my record to sound like." We were like,
"Is that how he sounds?"
Yeah. Oh yeah. You should have JV on the on the show. Yeah, but it's crazy because he really would see music, you know, in ways that and he would communicate in ways that were just kind of like supernatural. You know, he was on a frequency that I really, really give him so much credit for, because I really feel like he's really tried his best to be focused. And you walk into the studio in the morning, and instead of saying, "Hey, how about those Dodgers?" he's saying, "We need to spread a spiritual virus." You know, and that sets the tone for the session. And that sets the tone for, we're like, "Oh my gosh, yes, thank you, Carlos. Thank you for reminding us that we are, again, we are spiritual beings here with a responsibility as artists." So we met with Carlos up at his home in San Rafael, California, Northern California, and so he just brought us into all this, his spiritual aura. You know, it's really beautiful, and as we were we would talk about so much spiritual stuff, and then as we were leaving the first day, he said, "Oh, I want you to have this present," and he gave us a copy of The Hidden Words, and I think he had another book of Conversations with God, and he signed the books and gave them to us. But we were like, "Wait a minute, Carlos, so you know about the Baha'i faith and everything?" And Carlos was like, he said, "Oh, it's beautiful." And every time we talk about religion, he would always say, "It doesn't matter if you're Buddhist, if you're Baha'i, if you're Christian, you know, whatever, you know," and we were very, and he would say that on stage too. And just really somebody who, in his words, he always talked about embrace your absoluteness, you know. And mm-hmm. so it's kind of back to that mm-hmm. whole concept of oneness, the oneness of humanity, and the oneness of God, and the oneness of everything. So anyway, so he really wanted us to infuse that into the music. So we were really given this responsibility to try to do something. And there's a song that JB and I, during the Baha'i fast, I guess it was 98, or I don't know, I guess 98 before the record came out. And we were reading a writing, and I found a quote. I think this is the one that says, "Soon the whole world, as in springtime, will change its garb. The turning and falling of the autumn leaves is past. The bleakness of the winter time is over. The new year hath appeared, and the spiritual springtime is at hand. The black earth is becoming a verdant garden. The deserts and mountains are teeming with red flowers. From the borders of the wilderness, the tall grasses are standing like advance guards before the cypress and jessamine trees. While the birds are singing among the rose branches like the angels in the highest heavens, announcing the glad tidings of the approach of that spiritual spring. And the sweet music of their voices is causing the real essence of all things to move and quiver." And we were in the Baha'i fast is 19 days prior to the new year, which is the spring equinox. So we were approaching this, you know, this new spring and looking at everything around us is beautiful, but knowing also that the Baha'i faith talks about that we are living in this spiritual springtime right now. So that's something that we wanted to try to talk about in a song. So we wrote a song called Primavera. And it says in the verse, it says, "La tierra negra se vuelve verde y las montañas y el desierto un bello jardín." So the black earth becomes a verdant garden, and the mountains and the deserts become a beautiful garden. And then the chorus says, "Como la semilla lleva nueva vida, hay en esta primavera una nueva era." So it's just like like the seed that carries new life, there is in this springtime a new era. You know, and Carlos just like lit up when we played it for him. Yeah. So, I mean, I could tell you the whole, more. I don't know how much time we have, but yeah.
Well, just do it. Just tell us everything.
Well, every time.
Just start from the beginning.
Well, the funny thing about that song was, as we were putting it together, so Carlos, he said, I love it. So we went in the studio, started working on it. And Carlos came out to the studio and we worked on the solo for the song, and then he left, and then we stayed up for hours, you know, constructing and deconstructing the solo, and we're like, yeah, we think we got it, you know. We cut and edited his solo, and it's beautiful now. And then the following morning he walks in, he said, and we're like, hey Carlos, we got something for you. And he said, oh, I got something for you guys too. We're like, oh, what is it? You know, like, we defer to his greatness. And
yeah,
he says,
yeah.
I was thinking about, because we were so excited to play him the intro to the song, right? And he said, I was thinking about the intro to the song and how, instead of being like this, you know, this handshake, this like this strong handshake, I wanted to be more like a warm embrace. And we were like, yeah, that sounds great. He said, like, kind of like the sun when it's coming up on the horizon in the morning, the sunrise, you know, it slowly starts to warm you. He said, you know, and we're like, yeah, that sounds great. He said, also, you know, if you would indulge me, can you let me play it for you, you know? Are you kidding? And it's like that kind of humility and that level of respect and trust that he had for us and in us, you know, it was just, I mean, made for the most perfect kind of working relationship. But so he starts playing this melody, and it's like this. And it was just beautiful melody that just felt like, yeah, we get it. But he really is thinking, he's thinking with those kind of images in his head. Colors sometimes. And we always joked about Carlos going to say, oh, can I have my solo more green? Or, you know, we always joke. And he really never did that, which is, I mean, because that would be maybe too predictable, right? but there was one moment when he said, we were working on, I think after the second album we did, after Supernatural, we were doing a single for another record, and he said, oh, that mix, it feels a little, I think he said, it feels a little red, or can you make it redder, you know? And it was like, we knew that it was, maybe it just needed to be warmer, perhaps, you know, or that, those, you know, so we got to kind of, finally we got to guess at what he meant by that particular color.
Right.
But it was a real beautiful experience working with him, because he did allow us to use our spiritual, you know, our excitement and spiritual energy, and put that into something that he wanted to see, you know, hit the airwaves, and he wanted to spread the spiritual virus.
Wow.
Yeah.
That is like, I'm so glad we captured that. That's so precious.
Yeah.
And so, to have that experience with such a greatness. I don't even know how to call him.
Yeah.
He's not a prophet. But
No, but he really is exemplary in the musical world, for sure.
So speaking of great musicians, in 2001, you also joined forces with none other than Michael Jackson, following the attacks on, the attacks on the World Trade Center. And you worked on a benefit song called What More Can I Give? Is that correct?
Yeah, we worked on, the Spanish version. Yeah.
How did that kind of come about, or what was that experience like?
Yeah, we got the call, and Michael wants to meet and wants to talk about this thing that he had already started. They started working, Beyonce had sung the demo and throughout in English. And so we took the song and we did a Spanish version. And it was just kind of like, you know, can you help make this happen? So it's really start calling people, and immediately I called Ricky, I called you know, we called Ricky, we called Shakira, we called everybody. And before we knew it, we had Celine Dion on the track. We have John Secada, you name it, Luis Miguel, Shakira, everybody. It was Gloria Estefan, Julio Iglesias, Luis Miguel, Olga Tañón, the biggest names in the Latin world. And yeah, so it was great. And Michael came in one day and I was piecing it all together, and he just heard it, and he started tears coming down his face, and he just looked at me and he said, "I love it, and can you help me do the English version?" The English version.
Wow.
Yeah. So the English version was already kind of underway, and it's kind of it's tough when you have a lot of people working on, you know, something, a lot of chefs.
Yeah.
But luckily for me, the Spanish one really represented my vision, and it's so that I'm very proud of how that turned out. We even had Luther Vandross at the end, and oh man, it's just crazy. Juan Gabriel, if you've heard of any of these names, but did the biggest names. But so that was Michael's attempt to do something. He really had such a big heart and wanted to do something to honor the victims or the families, or for the families of the 9/11 tragedy. Anyway, it was kind of like a We Are the World, you know, follow-up.
Now, we've talked a lot about this theme of oneness throughout this interview. You're one of the founding members of Oneness, a nonprofit organization that promotes racial unity through music, arts, and education. Through his writings, the founder of the Baha'i faith, Baha'u'llah, shares that we are all created from the same dust, and that we are like the fruits of the same tree and leaves of the same branch. You've described the Oneness Initiative as a global movement that's bringing the Baha'i-inspired perspective of oneness and racial unity to a secular world. Could you elaborate on this project, how it came about, what it entails, and who you've also been able to collaborate with?
Right around the same time, we were talking about 1999, 2000, it came to a point where we were thinking, our family, Faith Holmes, and I were talking. We have these late night jacuzzi meetings, right? and she said, okay. She says, "Oh man, we should do something for, you know, to help fight racism." And, you know, and I said, "Yeah, we could do a song." Or she said, "We should do a song for that." I said, "Why do a song? Why not an album?" And I kind of like, you know, hey, ambitious. And we're like, "Why not? Let's do something big," you know, because we had a lot of resources. We were really, you know, in a great place, and we knew people from Recording Academy or people from all the music industry, people, labels and whatnot. So we decided, let's do something. They said, "Well, what do we do with all the money when we get all the money from the record sales?" Very naive. It kind of just led us into thinking like, well, we have to have a nonprofit, or we, you know, so all of a sudden we started thinking about, what if we had something that was using music to fight racism and promote the oneness of humanity, you know? So we started Oneness, and so we were trying to figure out developing what kind of things we could do. And the first thing that kind of came to mind was the Oneness Awards. We did that, but then it was the Songwriter Summit was what the idea of bringing together up-and-coming songwriters to create music, but really pushing the envelope with, you know, different styles in each room. We had a drumming circle and an inspirational speech at the beginning. Joy DeGruy, you know, came out and talked to us about her African experience. And one year, we did this for various years. The year that really stands out was when we took over the Jim Henson studio lot, where they, you know, the Muppets and Chaplin stage, where A&M Records used to be. And we had, you know, this amazing array of musicians, and the whole purpose was to create music that would speak to the oneness of humanity, or at least that had a theme of social justice. And it was a beautiful thing. So we did that, and we had these, like I said, the Power of Oneness Awards, honoring people in the industry, in any kind of entertainment industry that were doing great things with their work, TV, film, or whatever. Mm-hmm. I don't know. That was, and then we do different mentorship kind of projects as well for kids. We and Faith and Dennis Holmes kind of were running it, and it got to be a lot of work. And it, I think at a time, this is before Black Lives Matter, so there was a, I think it was, there was a lot bubbling, but people didn't really see the need for it yet. You know,
yeah.
So everybody said we were kind of ahead of our time, but I still think that the whole concept of oneness is so important. And what we, you know, we're still doing things around the world, and we'll bring oneness, the concept of oneness, into the projects and that we do. And you know, but that was a really special moment in time.
I want to now segue this conversation about oneness to now talk about your recent album release. In November last year, you released your second solo record, Cruzanderos, which you've described as following the immigrant's journey and the masses of souls looking for a new life in a new land. Could you walk us through this record, some of the themes, stories, and messages that are rooted in the lyrics of your songs, and maybe the unique instruments and traditional sounds that feature on the album, and who you are also blessed to record with?
Yeah. Well, it was a beautiful, beautiful opportunity to call on a lot of the people that I had been working with through my career. One of them was like Gabby Moreno, the young Guatemalan singer. We also brought in La India, who's I had written or actually produced back-to-back hits for her. She's a salsa artist, and we did her pop stuff. And she's always been a good friend and a fan, and just the, you know, that's what you want. You want someone who likes your music to sing on your record.
Course.
So she came in and sang on a song called Pasaporte. Gabby sang on a song called Quisiera, which is kind of like talks about the poverty and the wealth that kind of like are at play in Guatemala. Was really my where my head is at, and I hope to do a video with that song at some point. Also Gustavo Santaolalla, the guy that I mentioned earlier, the producer and the film composer, he played on a song called Virgen del Sol. He played the charango, and then I have a song called Tanta Locura, which is kind of like this mystical kind of song about, you know, just desperately looking for your beloved everywhere. And very much like Majnun and Layli, the story, kind of like the Romeo and Juliet story that's alluded to a lot in the Baha'i writings. So it has a spiritual side.
Well, you've mentioned that your songs give voice to the people, and this really resonated with me when I watched some of your music videos from this album, particularly Canto, which you've already touched on, and it focuses on indigenous people's universally intrinsic relationship with the land and environment. Could you walk us through the themes and melodies in this song, which you said you worked on with JB, who's a musical colleague of yours, particularly for our non-Spanish speaking listeners, including myself?
Yeah, Canto. So it's maybe I'm trying to think of how the video kind of helped define things a little more, because we decided to focus on four different characters that were representing different Native American tribes from South America all the way to North America. And so really touching on kind of the themes that are kind of afflicting the planet, that are basically caused by you know, corporate greed and the burning of the forests, or the polluting of the water. But the song says canto de la tierra, canto de la tierra, latiendo como un corazón. It's just a song from the earth, song from the soul. I sing so that the people will wake up, so that the people will listen. But it tells a story of just the foggy morning in the jungle as the sun is rising, and it's bringing new hope and possibility. And then it's like a prayer B section that says Ilumina desde arriba. It says illumine from above. Dame el coraje y la fe y la verdad cantaré. give me the courage and the faith, and I will sing the truth. Yeah, so it's a very colorful video. If you go to my website, you can click on the video. It's kcporter.com, KC Porter. And there's that, and there's also the first single, which is La Pared, off the album, and that's about the walls that divide us. So it's just more of a simple song that's, you know, just is like another day. Let me see what I have a version that I did separate from the album. It's a little more like a boom, 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 like a joropo, like a cueca mitza. And that's another thing, is because I don't have to worry about, if I was from Ecuador, it would have to be right. If I was from Peru, it would have to be right. But because I'm kind of from LA, I can mix and match in ways that they, mm-hmm. you know, percussionists have told me, the greatest percussionists have said, "Hey man, you can't do that." You know, it's like, well right. But does it work? And he said, "Well, yeah, but you can't really do that." So, but it works. It works, and we love it. You know, and he's like, "Yeah, you're right. You know, hey, it's actually working." Yeah, but there's like the clave thing, the three, you know, the 3-2-2-3 clave thing that everybody, uh-huh. you know, we all the time, we're joking about it, and we hear here in the studio the guys are saying like, "Hey man, you have to add that little beat, because otherwise you break the clave pattern." And uh-huh. that clave pattern is like this hidden code that you have to respect and observe. But if you break it, all of a sudden you're, you know, hey, you know, now you're the rule breaker, and maybe you get like, everybody's like excited or angry. But back to the song. So La Pared is about the walls that, you know, about the wall in particular, that is and the video is a story of a father and his daughter that are separated at the border. And I can do a little bit. So it's like, I don't know, this is crazy. Anyway,
it's all in your head. You're trying to bring it out.
I don't know, that sounds okay. Ya como en la frontera, ¿quién lo puede imaginar? Unos pasos y otros quedan, cada quien con su verdad. Que le quita la esperanza, que le exige regresar, de quién fue la absurda idea de esa línea imaginaria tan difícil de cruzar. Que se caiga la pared, que se junte mi gente, que se caiga otra vez. Lo digo de frente, que se caiga la pared, se junte mi gente, que se caiga otra vez. You know, that kind of thing. Little South American
Beautiful.
Thing, but that
was, I loved that version. That was just the stripped down version. That
yeah,
was gorgeous.
I like that more, you know, but it's like, I sat at the piano, I'm like, I'm a piano player. How am I going to do this without a percussionist? Now I like this better. So now I don't need a percussionist, at least for that song. But then with the percussionist, it's cool.
We'll get a better recording than this one. But I think that version was so emotional and beautiful.
Oh, I know. And my vocals
Thank
probably way
so
louder
much
than
for
the
sharing.
Piano.
No, it
Sorry.
Was perfect. So. Thank you. Another song I was curious to learn more about is Quisiera, track 10 on your album, which explores themes of economic equality and the eliminations of extremes of wealth and poverty, which is a fundamental principle of the Baha'i faith. Could you elaborate on the inspiration behind this song?
Exactly what you said. Yeah, I think taking that into consideration, you know, how is this big gap of the extremes of wealth and poverty, how are they affecting us? And I think that's something that I got to see a lot in Guatemala. You know, you'd see the kids being picked up at, you know, in their Mercedes Benzes, and then people that are like begging at the bus stop, you know. And I had to take three buses to get to my piano lesson. So I always remember standing at the multiple bus stops and watching the Mercedes Benzes drive by. And I was always thinking like, oh man, it's like, it's such a crazy, crazy extreme that, you know, just a handful of people that own most of the land here. And the indigenous population is like 60% in Guatemala, and they don't have voting rights. They don't know how do they vote? You know, they don't know, you know, their rights. They're not afforded their rights. And when they try to get rights, or anybody tries to help them get rights, it's like it becomes a political issue, or it's like, oh, it's, you know, they're communist if they're helping them. You know, it's just like, it's really, really, it's a real serious issue, because these are people. This is the population of Guatemala, the original inhabitants of Guatemala. And to just be everything's taken away from them. And so I'm sensitive to that. I am, you know, I don't know. I don't know. All I can do is try to share a little of that. But I think it's not the solution in any way. But I think we do need to become aware of what is happening around us right now. Malnutrition in Guatemala is the worst in all of America. There's, you know, they say, I think 50% of all children in Guatemala are malnourished. So what does that mean? You know, that's why people are fleeing Latin America partially because there's no jobs, or there's drought, and there's no, so, you know, if your only food that you can get maybe is corn, and if you don't even have the right tools to be able to grind it, you know, it's just like, it's bleak. And then of course, then the violence that people are fleeing from Guatemala is getting worse, but it's still not as bad as Honduras or El Salvador. But my heart has deep roots in Guatemala, but it's always a challenge to figure out what can we do? How can we help? But I think, you know, trying.
And do you hope that, like, I have a few questions about just your vision with your music, because you're addressing these really hard-hitting issues that are not just relevant to South America, they're relevant to the world. I mean, your story of, like, the injustice around indigenous populations is very familiar to me living in Canada. So who do you hope is, like, listening to your songs and most impacted? And what do you hope to really overall achieve with your music and your lyrics?
Well, it's interesting because I did go to school, a number of schools in Guatemala, but I ended up at the American school. And I remember a lot of the people that were in my class and other classes, they were the more affluent people in Guatemala. And so I think about some of the people I know still are people that are well-connected, well-off. And I'm hoping that, you know, I can, you know, kind of be a constant reminder to anybody out there that, you know, that there's still a lot of stuff that needs to be done, but I feel like we keep falling back in the comfort that we know. And how do you put yourself out there and it can be dangerous too. I mean, because Guatemala and Latin American countries, there's a lot of kidnapping, a lot of stuff like that. So there's all kinds of stuff to be aware of. But I think when you have those kind of extremes of poverty and wealth, it's only a matter of time before it's going to start getting, you know, it's going to get worse and worse. And the stories are starting to surface, although people have been trying to keep under wraps so that no one really knows about that, so tourism doesn't drop, you know, but stuff is happening. And it's because people are, you get desperate, you're hungry, you want to, you know, you'll do whatever it takes. And that's, it's human nature. So we really, you know, we need to do a lot of work.
Hmm. I mean, what I'm hearing from you is that you really want your music to be a voice for the voiceless, but also to draw attention to a lot of those injustices and to those people in power, to pay attention, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, yeah, and be open to hearing everybody's voice. And I understand that there's two sides. The whole, our you know, the United States being so polarized, it's telling, because there's truth to all everybody's perspective. No one is all right, and no one's all wrong, you know.
You've had such a full and extensive career in music, and looking back, what experience has really stood out to you or been a highlight for you?
Musically, I feel like meeting someone like Santana was, you know, and people, when you find the people that are at the, you know, the most respected artists, or like Celine Dion, you know, when you walk into the studio, or walk in and say, if it's not too much trouble, do you mind if I have 5 minutes to breastfeed my baby? You know, I never forgot that, because it's kind of like, you know, she could be whatever she wants to be. She could say whatever she wants to say, and no one's going to complain, but she has that respect for all people. It's really stayed with me too. And I found that kind of communication really works well. And it makes everybody part of this whole process, either musical process or this process of life. You know, what can we do? You know, consulting, as you mentioned too, that is so important.
I know you're an incredibly humble person, but if I may ask, what do you owe these achievements and accolades to in your life?
I feel like the sacrifices my parents made so that I could, you know, to take us to Guatemala. I really feel that starting with that, which is, it gave me that opportunity to be a little bit more aware of the world around me. I think in the writings, one of the things it talks about is accustoming your children to hardship. And I think that stepping out of my suburban LA life really did give me that opportunity to, it wasn't even as much a hardship, but it's just exposing me to a world, another world, and just to be open-minded more so. You know, coming back to the United States was a culture shock for me. It wasn't the other way around. You know what I mean? Coming back is just like, oh my gosh, this is just like, wow. The materialism factor here was very visible. But now being here, it's just kind of like, oh, well, it's everywhere. And it's like, oh, well, if I can buy it, why can't I buy it? If I can own it, if I can, you know. But then you create a big, big headache for yourself. Then you have all stuff. Then you have to figure out where to put your stuff, you know?
Yeah. Well, before we close, we always like to ask our artists what they've got coming up in the pipeline. So what have you got coming up in the pipeline?
Oh, after I produce this Mexican rock band, Panteón, I think I'm going to be flying to Spain to do my third album. The song Tanta Locura, really, off my album, kind of gives you a taste of something that really just moves me a lot. I feel like the music of the rumba flamenca is it's so deep and so passionate, and maybe it'll rub off a little bit onto my Western soft, you know, demeanor. You know what I mean? It's just very, very steeped in this, ole, you know, very powerful.
Yeah.
And but I love it. So that may be that's what I'm hoping to do this year. So hope to see something. I think I'll release a single or two at a time, little by little.
Just casually.
Yeah.
Why not?
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. Who knows?
Yeah. Oh, that's exciting. Yeah. Casey, we've sadly come to the end of this episode of Cloud Nine, but I want to thank you so much on behalf of the team at BahaiTeachings.org for joining us and taking the time to share your stories. I've been so inspired by your journey and
thank you.
How you've been able to serve humanity through your work and your efforts as an artist. So I look forward to catching up in the future and seeing what you're able to achieve in the next year or so.
Thank you so much. Yeah, it's been a real pleasure talking to you. And yeah, look forward to this, the future here.
Next chapter.
Yes.
Awesome. Thank you again. Take care.
Thank you. Take care.
Thanks so much for listening to Cloud 9. I hope you enjoyed this episode. Feel free to check out BahaiTeachings.org, where you can find more Baha'i-inspired podcasts, videos, and articles.